Good morning. China's National Day parade got over a few hours ago, where there was a spectacular display of the PLA capabilities. It is said that nearly 30-40% of the platforms which are there on display, they are new platforms never been showcased before, and they are the ones either about to enter or they have already entered the PLA inventory. Two things that caught my attention, and really these are the things which have inspired this sort of an impromptu video, was the hypersonic cruise missile and the hypersonic glide vehicle which was on display. Now this is a capability which could be the non-nuclear deterrence in the 21st century. Now what this means is that if we are talking of the hypersonic cruise missiles and the hypersonic glide vehicle as the non-nuclear deterrence, it will have implications on the nuclear deterrence. Plus, insofar as India is concerned, it will have more implications for the conventional war fighting. So, first of all, let's understand what this capability is and then we proceed further. So, what was on display there was the DF-100 hypersonic cruise missile, supposed to have a range of 3000 kilometers, and also on display was the DF-17 and the DF-41 ballistic missiles. Now, DF-17 is a medium range ballistic missile with a range of about 2500 kilometers. And DF-41, as we know, is the intercontinental ballistic missile. Now, these two, the rockets of this capability of the ballistic missiles, are the ones which are supposed to provide the boost to the hypersonic glide vehicle, which is called the DFZF. This has a range of 2000 kilometers. So, what happens is that the boost is given by the D-17 or the D-41, and thereafter the hypersonic glide vehicle separates and then it maneuvers and it goes towards the target. Now, when we talk of hypersonic cruise capability, cruise missile or the glide vehicle, now we are talking of something entirely different. Till now, we were familiar with the ballistic missile capability, which basically meant that the rocket trajectory, once the rocket shoots off, it will leave the atmosphere, it will re-enter the atmosphere, and it will follow a trajectory, a arc which is well defined. So it can be tracked by the land-based radars. Then we have the cruise missiles. In the case of cruise missiles, again, this missile does not leave the atmosphere. It goes at low altitudes, and throughout the flight it is powered by a jet engine, which is basically an air breathing engine, till it hits the target. Now this can have long ranges, and the cruise missiles basically they are guided right till the target, till they reach the target. Now, this hypersonic capability is basically something in between the two, and this is where the problem comes. All the systems, I mean, America spent about 40 years, more than 40 years, working on the ballistic missile defense. We also started our program on the ballistic missile defense, which I will talk a little later. And now, then the world moved to the lower spectrum. They came to the cruise missiles. So now for the cruise missile defense also the capability exists. Now hypersonic is something entirely different. And how it is different is in two major ways. First is the speed. Now we are talking of speeds. When it comes to hypersonic, we are talking of more than 5 Mach, 6 Mach, 7 Mach, 8 Mach and so on. Mach being the speed of the sound. For example, we have our own spectacular BrahMos hyper supersonic cruise missile now, which uses a ramjet engine, and it gives us a speed of up to Mach 3. But this supersonic speeds are much more than 5 Mach. But this is one distinctive feature of this missile. The other main thing about this missile is it stays within the atmosphere. It's somewhere between the ballistic arc and the cruise arc. It is low flying altitude it takes, certainly more than the cruise missiles. And the key thing about hypersonic is it is highly maneuverable. Now, what this means is that, first of all, like a cruise missile which goes at low altitude, it is difficult to get it on the land-based radars. And once you get it on the land-based radars, then the big problem in the case of hypersonic missile, which is not the case with a ballistic or a cruise missile, is that you just don't know where it is headed, because it will keep maneuvering, keep changing its path. So that is where the big problem comes. So when we see this distinctive feature about the hypersonic cruise missile and a hypersonic glide vehicle, which basically means that once it has left the main rocket which boosted it and it starts gliding, it can glide to 2000 kilometers and it will not be known, it will not be clear till you are very close to the target, which exact target it's trying to hit now. I mean, the Americans have worked out, or their thinking is that this is a capability which needs to be immediately taken note of. I remember at the recent Paris Air Show, where I was there and I could interact with the Raytheon senior officials, they were absolutely worried, and their main worry was the land-based sensors will not be able to detect the hypersonic cruise missiles. So what do? We need to now have different type of sensors altogether, sensors based in space. I mean, one of the reasons why recently the Americans have announced, the Trump administration has announced the creation of a space command. So you see, this is a capability which is so unexpected, which can do so much, and this can really create total uncertainty in the battlefield. Now, our challenges, India's challenges, what do we about it? So look, there is no point, because what I hear when I talk to the people here, so they keep telling me that, look, it is still far away, it is not happening anytime soon. Well, that's incorrect. Now, if it is on display on October 1st, it's very much in the inventory also already. Let's get that correct. And the second thing what people tell me in the DRDO is that our defense services are not taking adequate interest in this capability. Perhaps they are not able to understand where this capability fits in the battlefield, and hence, unless they will not take interest, we cannot get the funding for this research. See, this is where we always lose the game. Now, take the case of ballistic missile defense. I mean, ballistic missile defense, our indigenous ballistic missile defense, was inspired basically by the American ballistic missile defense. And I remember meeting the then DRDO chief, Dr. V.K. Saraswat, in 2010. And these are the timelines he gave me. He gave me that, now I'm talking of ballistic, I'm not talking hypersonic, this is a new thing altogether. Insofar as the indigenous ballistic missile defense was concerned, he told me that all the systems in phase one. Now, what is phase one? Phase one is that we will be able to take on hostile missiles with a range of 2000 kilometers. So all those systems for phase one will be put in place by 2013. This he told me in 2011. And what are the systems he was talking about? He was talking about, first of all, there are four things which are there. You need the long-range tracking radar. I mean, we know that we got some radar system, the Green Pine radar from the Israelis, which had a range of about 600 kilometers. And this was extended to, a bit, but it's exactly how much is not known. Then you need, once the hostile missile is identified, you need two type of interceptors. You need an interceptor which can intercept the missile, because the missile needs to be intercepted both outside the atmosphere, you know, and inside the atmosphere, for the reason that if it, the first interceptor misses, the second should be able to get it. So we needed an interceptor for the outside the atmosphere, which they called PAD, pad, and then an interceptor inside the atmosphere. You see, the distance, rough distance between where the atmosphere ends, the altitude, is about 100 kilometers. Beyond 100 kilometers is space. And the second interceptor was required, which they called AAD, which was inside the atmosphere, ENDO. Then there was a need for a multifunctional fire control radar, which they had acquired one from Thales company, giving a coverage of about 350 kilometers. And then, of course, you need the battle management command control computer intelligence system, basically the command post. So what you need is the two interceptors, you need the long range tracking radar, you need the multifunctional fire control radar, and you need the command post. So I was told by General Saraswat that phase one, that means all hostile missiles, you know, we are talking now of Pakistan, let's say the Hatab series, we'll be able to take them on and neutralize them by 2013. And he said by 2015, the phase two will also be over. Now, what is phase two? Phase two is looking at hostile missiles with a range of 5,000 kilometers. Now, these timelines have not been met. Why do I say that? Because if these timelines were met, what was the need for us to buy the Russian S-400 system? I mean, we've gone and bought five regiments of S-400, which is absolutely a fantastic system. But obviously, it does not cater for the hypersonic cruise missiles. It is not meant for that. We've got it, and it will come and it will get integrated. It's a wonderful system. Not only that, the outgoing Air Chief Marshal B.S. Dhanua, since he has retired, so I don't mind saying that, he was pressing also for the American National Advanced Surface to Air Missile System, which is the NASAM system, to also be got into the Air Force. Now, they would have worked out some operational use of both. The long and short is, we are looking at the better system, which is the S-400, which can take on the ballistic missiles, because NASAM cannot do that. But long and short is, neither of them can look after the hypersonic cruise missile. So why I'm dwelling on this is a bit to make the point, we need to look at this, we need to do a technical audit of the ballistic missile defense. I mean, we are also talking of MIRVs that we will put on this. I mean, it's all good. If we have not been able to meet the deadlines, and if there is a new capability which has come, we do not know what the Chinese will do with this capability. How much of that, as part of the interoperability, they will transfer it to the Pakistanis? We don't know all this. But this will happen, because the capability has already come in the theater. It was there on display. So we have to find, I mean, it's, to my mind, it's an emergency thing. I mean, the defense minister needs to hold an emergency meeting on this and see the path forward. How do we move? How do we take on this big asymmetrical threat which has emerged? So one suggestion that comes to mind is, because right now there are only three countries in the world which are known to have made big strides in this new capability, the hypersonic cruise missiles, which is America, Russia, and China. Now, we already have the BrahMos system with us. In fact, it's only yesterday BrahMos did another successful test, showcasing, saying that lot of the systems which were used, now they are indigenous. In fact, they are saying that already 70% of the missile and 100% of the ground systems, they all are indigenous, and they are moving towards complete indigenization of the systems. Moreover, BrahMos is a tested system. We all are, it's a national pride. It is there in all the three services with us, and they also have very definitive, achievable, futuristic plans. Along with that, this is the only DRDO, it's a DRDO venture, but of course it is, it's a joint venture with the Russians. It's a collaboration between Indian DRDO and Russia, but it has always kept to the timelines. It has met all the timelines. So one of the things that needs to be considered, I mean, there's no time for dithering. No dithering should be there at all now at this time. So one of the things could be considered is that our relations with Russia are very good, and we already have this successful system BrahMos. All we need to do is take it now to the next step. Take it to the step of the scramjet engine. Scramjet is, we are looking now at Mach 5 and Mach 6 capability speeds. And then we have to consider how to convert this into a hypersonic cruise missile, a glide vehicle and a cruise missile. I mean, these are the things which have to start now. They cannot wait. And the defense services have to be convinced that, look, this is a capability that you will need now. So we better gear up for all this. So this was the sense of my talking on this hypersonic capability, which has already come into the theater in our neighborhood, and I am absolutely convinced that a lot of it, quantum we can't say, will be shared with Pakistan also. So we have to now gear ourselves to this, to meet this challenge, and it is about time that we reach out to Russia for assistance, for hand holding. There is no other way. So this is what I wanted to say. Thank you very much.